All right, it is that time once again. This is the pre-show. If I was really fancy, I'd eventually cut this part out, but I'm not that fancy. All right, four people here. Gonna let people come in. I am going to, once again, this is now part of the show. I have to go to YouTube, find my own stream, and then copy that into, am I seeing the chat? Oh yeah, I can see the chat. All right, so yeah, I just have to go on Twitter and post this. You'd think that I could figure out how to do that beforehand, but I don't know. The link they give me on YouTube doesn't really work, so I have to like go paste it myself. How's it going for you guys? How's your week going? All right. Okay, I posted it on Twitter. Bell gang. Honestly, I'm flattered that there is a bell gang. There's people that have the bell. That's really sick, actually. Okay, I'm configuring the windows. Let's take like a second and just let people get in here. I know, people should be watching the clock. Honestly, people should just wake up Tuesday morning and stare at their phone for like 10 hours waiting for me. Oh, I don't have my gloves on yet. Well, I just doxed my hand. CIA is gonna find me. Okay. Just wait a second and let some people come in. What's going on with you guys, man? It's Tuesday night. I don't know if you guys, oh, can you guys hear these birds outside? Hold on a second. I don't know if you can hear them, but it's pretty awesome scenery-wise. So I'm obviously in like the art studio. And I have my carport right outside this window. And there's like part of it where it's falling down. Like the side of the carport is like falling down. And I was going to fix it. But these like robins, these birds are nesting in there. It's insane. There's like a huge nest. It's like a bird condo over here, and it's pretty loud. I think it's registering on the mic. Hold on one second. I don't know. I'm not gonna go bring the mic up to the window, but it's pretty awesome. Can hear birds out of 10. Yes. Feeling under the weather. I don't know. Coronavirus. No, I'm just playing, dude. Yeah. Yeah. All right, cool. So you guys know the policy. I don't like making people that are on time wait for people that are late. So I also want to talk about something before I start painting, so let's just do it. We're doing it right now. Yeah. Going on, everybody? How is it going? Nice. I like the sickly mask with the music notes. That's a vibe right now. Intro, music, Painted Worlds. It's Painted Worlds. Check it out. Spotify, Bandcamp. He's on Twitter too. It's at Painted, I think it's WRLD. Painted Worlds. Check it out. That's the plug. That's the house band in the show right now. Anyway, I know we are, as they say, schmooting right now. I like that meme a lot. How's it going, everyone? It has been quite the week. It's been quite the week. What's going on in the studio over here? I got a lot of stuff going on. In my room right now, it's full of boxes. I'm printing. Well, I'm getting ready to print out the next batch of rosary prints. I did that today. Since I'm pushing the color theory thing really hard, actually, I'm just gonna do like an intro for a minute and just like talk about some stuff, and then we'll kick into like painting. I'm gonna grab these over here. So, thought this was kind of cool. So, I have this printer over here. Eventually, maybe I'll show it on the camera. It's insane. It cost me so much money when I moved out here. In case anyone doesn't know the story, I used to live in New York, and then I just moved out to like this very rural environment that I love. And along the way, I just picked up this like crazy expensive printer, and I kind of just factored it into my moving cost, so I didn't really notice, but it was like way too expensive. But it's really awesome. I can print on this like thick watercolor paper. So I was doing the new rosary print, so I did this one, right? The thing is, I have the camera manually focused, so I'm not gonna move it to like show the whole page. It doesn't really matter. I thought I would show this real quick because it relates to like the color theory stuff I've been bumping. So I did this first one, and the gradient you can see is like super subtle. It goes from this, wow, I got the marker roller right here. Wow, it's almost like I planned that. You can see the gradient's kind of subtle up here, down here. If you've been watching a lot and like paying attention, like the colors I've been using and talking about, what I really wanted was this cerulean blue fading into like a cobalt blue. Where's the cobalt blue? Boom, I got it right here. I wanted to do that because the first print was red. I wanted to change it up for each run. And I wanted to do blue because it's like Virgin Mary blue, and I just couldn't get the colors right. So I actually painted out a swatch of this color and scanned it so I could get the actual color that I want. And I was pretty stoked about that. And I thought it like related to like the color theory stuff we've been doing here, because like the only way I could get the color I wanted, I actually had to take these two tubes of paint and like paint out a swatch and then scan it and then get the color going. For me, it was just kind of relevant to what I talk about on the show, because I feel like I'm talking a lot about like how the analog colors are so different than the digital colors. So I got that going on. That was pretty cool today. And what else was I going to talk about? Oh yeah, so before I kick into like painting world, otherwise I've just been working. I don't know. I wish I could like ask you guys like how it's going, and then someone could answer me, and I could like see what's going down. But otherwise, for me, I've just been working in the studio. It's kind of like all I do. I actually am in here so much working. The other morning, I went to take the garbage out, and I stepped outside, and I was like, "Wow, I totally forgot what it's like to be outside. I've been inside for like 2 or 3 days like straight." But I like it, you know. Makes me feel kind of like masculine, honestly. Just like going really hard and like trying to hustle jobs and like work and stuff like that. When I'm doing freelance like graphic design work and illustration work and stuff, I call it like Grand Theft Auto style, because it's kind of like in Grand Theft Auto, like, you know, you go answer a payphone and someone's like, "I need you to move this thing over here for $250." Like, that's kind of how it is. I get these emails and I just answer them, and I don't know, because that makes it sound cooler than it is. Anyway, so first things first. So before I just hop into painting, in case this is the first time you're watching this, I have been experimenting with the format a little bit, trying to figure out exactly how I want things to go down. So before I hop into painting, last time I just hopped right in, I want to talk about something. So someone on Twitter hit me up and asked me about sketchbook stuff and sketching and things like that. I don't know if I should plug their name. I feel weird when people use their real name on Twitter, and then maybe I'm like shouting them out to all these like people. So I'm not gonna do that. But coincidentally, they also sent me this book, which was really tight. So I'm gonna plug the book also. It's this book called Rock and Sand by Josiah Trenum. It's a really cool book. It is basically an orthodox appraisal of the Protestant Reformation. So basically, it's like what the orthodox view of the Protestant reformers is and stuff like that. And you know, whether you're Catholic or Orthodox or Protestant doesn't really matter. You know, I thought it was just a really interesting book because it's a very particular viewpoint that is really, really well put forth and fleshed out. And I don't know, I feel like a big part of, you know, why I like being online is like hearing people talk about different like theological views and stuff like that. And this was just such an awesome like one guy laying out his particular like very specific view. So I really recommend this book. It's really easy to read and it's really awesome. So that guy sent me that book. That was really cool. I feel like I should plug his name, but I'm not going to. And he asked me about sketchbook stuff, and he kind of phrased it in an interesting way, because he was like, "You know, you talk about painting, but I'm kind of like on the road a lot, and I can't be like painting in my like, you know, spot that I'm in."
So I want to talk a little bit about sketchbook stuff, just because a lot of people, not a lot of people, but some people watch this, and not everyone is going to go out and like buy a bunch of paints. You know, it is like kind of a little bit of an investment. Like, you know, I work a job just like you guys. You know, I don't have a lot of money floating around. So sketching and having a sketchbook is a really easy way to like get your foot in the door art-wise. So yeah, I want to talk about that for a second. First off, I just kind of wanted to like show this. This won't take very long. I just wanted to give like a little plug. If you go to an art store, or even like, you know, if you don't have an art store near you, some cities don't have art stores, you can hit up like a Michaels or like a craft store. Sometimes stores that sell like girl craft supplies and like fabric and things like that. You can pretty much always find one of those. Yarn and things like that. We'll have the stuff you need to start like sketchbooking. You know, most expensive thing you could get, honestly, if you wanted to take it there, is like a pack of pens like this. The technical name for a pen like this is a pigment liner, but no one ever calls it that. They're just microns. Anyone that's ever been involved in art in any capacity has probably seen like a trillion of these. There's microns. There's other pens. Like there's this one called Stadler. I really like these a lot. And this is just a 101 in case anyone doesn't know. Obviously, I already opened this pack. But when you pick these up, they're gonna be different sizes. You can see the top over here. Man, I'm loving the camera situation. Using autofocus was such a mistake. This looks awesome. Yeah, they come with these numbers on top, and they're basically different thicknesses. So basically what this is, it's kind of like a super souped up pen. It has like a felty nib here, so you know, there's thick ones, right? And then there's thin ones. If you wanted to get a bunch of these, you would basically have everything you needed to start sketchbooking. Obviously, you know, it's kind of obvious, like, oh, go to the art store, buy a bunch of pens. But the real thing I wanted to talk about that I feel like I could provide insight on like keeping a sketchbook, is when I'm around people who are getting into drawing or want to start going with that, I feel like there is this wall where they have like a preconceived notion of how it should be when they start drawing. And that usually ends up being the biggest obstacle. A lot of things are not exactly intuitive when you first get started. Like, for example, here I have this pencil. So a lot of people, when they first start drawing, are like, oh, well, you know, I've seen people sketch, like artists sketch and stuff. Like, I need like a pencil. Pencil's perfect. I can erase. You know, you can get the light little lines going in. And then when I'm ready, I can put in the hard lines and stuff. So they get a bunch of pencils and stuff like that. That's fine if you want to like experiment at home and stuff, but actually, since it's not intuitive, that's why I'm bringing this up. I would actually not recommend that. If you're just starting out drawing, having a pencil and using that as your main like sketching device when you go out and draw things around you, which is what I'm going to talk about in a second, it actually really hinders you a lot because what people end up doing is since it has this pressure sensitivity, you feel like you need to like, okay, I'm drawing, you know, this apple and I'm just gonna put in these light little hairy lines and eventually, you know, I'll get the shape of the apple going on. It's actually a lot more conducive to you developing confidence as an artist and getting confident. Confident is like really the key word. For you to have a tool where you can't do that. So actually, most people wouldn't assume that, but pretty much any pen, like even this is just like a random pen I had laying around. When you're using something like this, obviously it has no pressure sensitivity in terms of opacity. It doesn't become transparent the lighter you're pressing. So something like this is actually way better to have around because what I would recommend you do if you get a sketchbook and want to start drawing is basically just go out, draw like literally anything. Anything around you, all the stuff you see, doesn't matter. Could be a chair, or I'm looking in my room right now, like a shirt on the floor, or this hat, or this coffee cup, or my car outside my window. Just go out and draw things around you. And the skill that you're developing is you're training your brain on how to, I want to phrase this well, on how to allow your eyes to give you visual information and then for you to translate that visual information into a two-dimensional art medium. So again, that's why the pencil is bad. Like let's say you're drawing like a car or something, like your friend's car like parked outside. This tool gives you the illusion that what you're going to end up with is some like super realistic sketch, and you're going to go in and be like, oh my God, I got to get all the light perfect on the bumper and stuff and make sure everything's all, you know, that's okay. It's one type of drawing. Like, I'm not telling you like not to do that ever, but it's almost better. And especially for things like on the fly, for you to just have a pen and then you have to figure out, okay, how am I going to translate what I'm seeing into this art medium that doesn't allow me to 100% completely try and copy reality. Obviously, if you're drawing in ink, you have to make some compromises in terms of, well, you know, let's say you're drawing even just like a ball that's sitting on the floor. You can't really get that perfect gradient that you're gonna see, so how are you gonna sketch it in? Are you gonna put in like a line and then go with like some kind of hatching situation? Maybe then you're gonna go back and get some other hatching in, and now you have to fully commit to this line that you made over here. It's already in, so maybe you kind of mess it up a little bit and there's this thing behind it and now you can't really see that perfectly. Basically, the fact that you can't erase the ink forces you to develop confidence. So anyone that's wondering like, oh, how do I start sketching, like keeping a sketchbook? That's what I recommend. Get some pens. It doesn't even have to be like fancy pens like this. Honestly, like this pen was probably like $1 at like Staples or something. You're totally good to go. And just keep it and draw the stuff around you. I actually have this old sketchbook here that I wanted to go through just super quickly. I'm keeping an eye on the clock because every time I've done this, I've looked at the clock for the first time and it's been like an hour and a half in. So I want to make sure I kind of like keep things moving. But I have this old sketchbook here. This is probably from like 7 or 10 years ago, honestly. I've been drawing for a really long time. But I just wanted to show you what I'm talking about, basically. So here, this is from when, this is like literally like 10 years ago. Maybe less, maybe like 8 years ago. I was in, I'm not going to say where, I was in an Eastern European country with some people. And I kept this little sketchbook and I was just drawing stuff around me. They had a baby, so you can see I'm drawing this baby. And you can see here what I'm talking about. Like, the fact that it's a pen, you just gotta go for it. Just leap off the cliff. In general, what people respond to when they look at art, I'm not talking about this really, like this is just a sketchbook, like who cares. But in general, when people look at art, and you'll notice this in yourself too, if you look at someone's art, it could be even just like a doodle or like an oil painting. What you're really responding to is the confidence in the decisions. When you're drawing and you're making an image, if you feel yourself not really being confident and you're like, oh, I'm drawing this girl's earring, but I don't know how it should be. I guess I'll kind of make it like this, I guess. People are going to feel that when they look at the image, as opposed to if you're like, you know what, yeah, I'm just going to go for it. It's an earring. It's like this. It's on the ear. Here's the hair. Here's her eye. People will sense that confidence and respond to it, and that's really what you want to get going for you. So yeah, you can see here just drawing like literally just random stuff around the house, random stuff in their backyard. And I'm only showing this because I think a lot of times people only see like the best perfect things that an artist is working on, and they don't see like the random just stuff generated in the background. So this is what I would frankly tell you to kind of like shoot for, not the style, you know, it's my own style, I guess, kind of, but just like this kind of thing, like just going out, like drawing a cat, drawing everything around you. You know, you're on your lunch break from work, maybe you can draw like some random stuff. This is my friend playing Xbox. I thought this was a pretty good drawing, actually. And you can see here, after doing this for a long time, I really noticed that my confidence in my line work got a lot better, just because, again, using the pen forces you to go for it. After a few months of just like drawing with pen, I'm really sure that your confidence in your decision making in terms of art will get a lot better. Let's go through a few more pages. We don't need to go through this whole thing. You can see here, drew this, and also it kind of like gives you ideas naturally while you're working. Like here you can see I drew this dog, and then later I drew my friend cooking something, and I kind of used the dog as like a window so you can see him in like this other room. That's also the other kind of function of a sketchbook. Just, oh, I love this drawing. Wow, this is awesome looking at this. I haven't looked at this in so long. It will kind of give you ideas naturally as you go along. So yeah, this is pretty good. Not to like hype myself up, this is a pretty good sketchbook. So yeah, if anyone wants to start, get going, and you're not gonna try and drop like $300 on paint, this is a really good way to start. You can get a super cheap sketchbook. This is even kind of a nice one. It's all like leather bound and stuff, but you can get a really cheap one. Just get a pen and just go for it. You can also see here, one thing I really like doing is, if you just even have like a marker, like these are just like really cheap markers. Doesn't really matter what you get. Just adding like a shade of color or one or two colors around. Will add another dimension to it. So yeah, that's basically it. I was thinking it would be good to kind of just go over this like super quickly because yeah, when this person asked me about the paints, I was like, yeah, true. Most people aren't going to go out and buy like $300 worth of paint right off the bat, but this is something anyone can do just driving around town. Oh, what a good note to end on. We'll kind of wrap it up here. But yeah, just like draw the stuff around you, and I think that would be a really good way to develop like your visual thinking and stuff like that. The other thing I wanted to show really quick was, in case anyone does go for it and do the sketchbook thing, the other thing that kind of happens, I've been around a lot of people who start doing art and then I see how their little journey goes, so I kind of like to talk about little like pitfalls people get into and how to not get into them. This is at the total other end of the spectrum. Sometimes what other people do when they get into art is they're like, okay, cool. I got this expensive sketchbook. I got the expensive tools. Look how nice this is. The pages are numbered. This is high end right now. And I'm going to make this the best sketchbook ever. And they'll just go for it. And they'll be like, yeah, every page is going to be perfect. You know what? Now I got the black going on. We are going to make every single page of this sketchbook the best thing anyone's ever seen. And every page is just like perfect drawings. And then what happens is you get pretty far in. This is the kind of stuff you see on my Patreon, by the way. I'm not trying to plug it. I'm just saying that's why no one's seen this. I put my sketchbooks on my Patreon. Oh, yeah. The Dominican vibe. You know I'm into the Dominican vibe. This is dope. I mean, I'm like looking at my own art being like, oh, it's so good. But I forgot about this drawing. It's really good. So what is really good, in my opinion, of course, it's my own style. I drew it. Hopefully you think your own drawings are cool. So eventually what happens is, you know, you put a dent in, like, look, let's see, how far did I get in here? I got to page 40. So I put like 20 drawings in here. And then what inevitably happens is you stop. This is from like months ago. So when you're trying to make it perfect, you get to this point where you're like, I don't want to mess it up. Like, I don't want to break my streak of like super perfect drawings. And then you stop using it. This is from like months ago. And I don't know if I'll ever really go back to this book, honestly. I mean, I will, cause I don't want to waste the paper, but I just noticed that happen a lot with people when they first pick up sketching and drawing, is instead of just going loose and hard and just going for it, they'll try and make everything perfect. And then that's what happens. You get like 30 pages into the book and then you're like, oh, well, I'll get another sketchbook and that'll be like the practice one. Don't do that. Just go for it. And that's basically the sketchbook talk. Get a pen, draw the things around you, draw everything around you. Last thing to mention there, and then we'll jump into painting. I do have a tutorial on my website, owencyclops.com. And if you go to comics, there's a little tab under there that says instructional. And in there, it's a full tutorial. I actually spend a lot of time on it. On how to draw still lives. So for that, you could get some nice tools like drawing pencils and stuff like that, but you could also just use a ballpoint pen and, you know, random printer paper around you. And it's a full tutorial, everything you need to know about light to draw like full-on classical still lives. Actually, if you read that and you really go for it and spend some time practicing with just that comic, you can go really far. You could definitely impress people with what you get up to. So yeah, that's what I recommend. That is the sketchbook talk. Anything else I should mention? Nah, man, that's basically it. And even if you think you wouldn't be good at drawing, or maybe you're like more of a writing person or whatever, it's still good to do. On another feed, maybe I'll do this in the beginning of the show or something. I'll go through one of my other sketchbooks and yeah, it's just a good way to keep track of your ideas. The sketchbook becomes kind of an extension of your brain, basically. So yeah, that's enough about that. Let's get to why we came here. I'm grabbing the palette. I have my palette on the floor. It's not a good place for it. I'm gonna peel off this last page. And let's get into it. Boom. Okay. I'm also kind of like mastering how to gauge looking at the chat while I am doing this, because I actually love the chat. I love like engaging with people, and it's really cool. It's kind of like one of the coolest parts of doing this. It kind of is the coolest part of doing it live, right? Otherwise, I would just do a video. But whenever I look at it, I start reading it, and then I can feel my train of thought like derailing. So I'm kind of trying to master like the middle ground between not keeping up with it, because that's impossible, but looking at it enough versus like not doing that. So I'm figuring that also. This is still like the test episodes. When they compile this, when historians go back and bring it all together, this will still be part of like the test episodes. I don't know if you guys can see, but there's some like shit on my paper. Cool. All right. So let's get this going. If this is your first time here, gotta throw down the border. Boom. In fact, in the sketchbook, actually, so that was a sketchbook that I had now, I would have been throwing down the border. I mention this every show, but that's like the biggest difference if you're just starting to do art, is whether or not you're composing the picture or just throwing it into like random infinite space. So let's get it going. Oh, I'm just going to look in the chat. So is this like, you guys see what I'm doing? Sound going well? I'm always like, where everyone's seen those streams where like the streamer gets like 25 minutes in and then they're like, oh, no one can hear me. I think we've all seen that happen, right? All right. He's watching us. Yes, I'm looking in the chat right now. But I'm not going to go back and read everything. Someone asked, oh yeah, I'll go back and look at it real quick. I'm not in my early 20s, I'm in my late 20s actually. Can't be more specific than that. Thanks for the shout out, Brum Moment. Ooh, I think Brum Moment is the guy that asked me about the sketchbook. I'm not sure though, actually. It's a different name. Maybe that's him though. If it's him, that's dope. What's up, man? All right. So, feel good. Feel a lot of like energy flowing right now. Just in terms of like coffee and caffeine, not in terms of like hippie energy. Although maybe a little bit of that too. So, what am I going for this week? In case you haven't been watching the older episodes also, I'm also figuring out exactly how much I should plan of the image before I jump in or not, and how much I should be like talking about that. I'm kind of figuring everything out, I guess you could say. And I feel like last time was the most successful one, where I talked about everything I was thinking and really just like totally winged it. I think the plan, the tentative MO, the tentative plan is I'll just keep winging it with no plan whatsoever until one just like totally bombs. Kind of inevitable, I guess that'll happen, and then I'll reevaluate. But until then, it's been going really well. And I'm just gonna keep winging it. I think it's like way more interesting too, honestly, instead of watching me like do paint by numbers or something. So here's what I'm thinking right now. That's the other thing. I'll stop saying this every episode eventually, but as long as people are still like catching up, I really wanted more so than like the painting technique aspect, because I mean, my painting technique is obviously, you know, second to none, super next level, obviously. But I think what's more interesting is just, you know, what I'm thinking about the symbolism or creating it and talking about creativity, not because I'm like some genius, because I really want to encourage other people to, frankly, explore being creative and stuff like that. So that's why. That's one thing I can say. I may not, you know, some people like my drawing, some people don't. That's totally cool. But one thing I have studied a lot is, you know, creativity and how it relates to the artistic process and the mind and stuff like that. So that is something I can definitely confidently say that I can talk about indefinitely, which is kind of why we're all here. All right, so I'm looking at my paints right now, and what I'm thinking image-wise, what I was thinking about this week a lot, is that I kind of have, you know, two modes, I guess you could say, when I'm doing images. On one end of the spectrum, I have 100%, let's call it like hyper-mystical theology mode when I'm making images, where everything is 100%, let's say, like spiritual realm status. I don't mean that in terms of like, you know, platonic solids and like ayahuasca visions and stuff. I mean just like the spirit realm in general, things that fit in, I should really say, with the spiritual aspect of life in a cohesive fashion. So like angels and castles, churches, natural things, roses, flowers, you know, very basic natural symbolism. Hold on one second, I'm drinking water. Cool. So, I have that mode, and that's normally the mode that I'm in. I often think of myself as, you know, there's a whole lineage of spiritual painters from, you know, all different religions, all different cultures. Sometimes I kind of think of myself as my cultures and intellectual scenes, this whole, you know, vibe that I'm on, I guess you could say, where I'm on the bottom. And I think of myself as like a painter in that way, making like sacred images for whatever strange world I inhabit, whatever you want to call it. On the other hand, one thing I like doing sometimes is inserting things that really don't go with that vibe, things that are almost like hyper mundane. And I feel like there's a really interesting thing that happens when, like, those two worlds kind of, like, meet up against each other. When you have the ideal realm, divinity, and things like that up against the world that we always are in, like, every day. That's something I used to do a lot. You know, I have this image where it's those two things, like, push right up against each other. Like, there's, like, you know, angels and ghosts and all these spiritual things, and they're in, like, a 7-Eleven parking lot. Or, like, you know, you're looking down this road, and there's, you know, this church, and it's illuminated by the sun, and there's this, like, OPHANIM wheel angel above the road, and there's, like, a donut truck, like, right there also. And I don't know why. Maybe it's just, you know, my own, like, stupid... I don't know if it's not really like a joke. I don't know why I find that so interesting. Maybe it's because, like, mentally I really do inhabit that world where I'm, like, doing the dishes and thinking about, like, hardcore theology, but then I'm looking at, like, you know, scraping, like, you know, food crumbs off this, like, really chintzy plate from some, like, restaurant or something. But I don't know. There's something about those two worlds, like, hitting up against each other. And I don't know. I kind of want to do something. I kind of want to do something in that realm. I also, every time I do this, try and do an image or use a type of, like, image framework that I haven't really used before. That's something else that I've talked about in the stream a lot, but I really easily could just, you know, draw something or paint something I've drawn, you know, 100 times before, and it would be completely perfect and it would look good. But I mean, does that really need to happen? Not really. It's more interesting to just kind of go out on a limb and see what we can make happen. So that's what I'm gonna do right now. I don't really know where this is gonna go, but I'm gonna start the scene inside. And I'm going to use this brown. Oh, Well, here's what I'm thinking. I was going to do a table right up here in the front. I could do a table cloth, and that would let me use some color and get some color in. But no, I'm not going to do that. Let's do this table. The color I'm going to use is burnt umber. So there's a few different browns that I like to use. But I like this burnt umber a lot. It's really easy to remember this kind of like color subtext for the different colors, because the burnt browns are red. Something's burnt, right? It's been near fire, so it's red. And then the raw ones, there's burnt umber and raw umber. The raw ones are yellow. So those are the two different kinds of browns. There's burnt umber, burnt sienna, raw umber, and raw sienna. Umber is the pigment, sienna is the pigment, and then the burnt or raw is like how it's been treated or not treated. How about that supernatural gas station night shift vibe? Dude, exactly. That is exactly the vibe. I really don't know why that's such a huge part of my vibe. Maybe it's because I work so many, like, random, quote-unquote, like, shitty jobs while thinking about all this stuff. Like, you know, like, going to some, like, you know, hyper-spiritual, like, Tibetan Buddhist retreat and then making sure I get back, like, Saturday morning in time to, like, be a cashier somewhere. That was a big part of my life. Maybe that's why. Not a big part, but a reasonable part. So yeah, let's try and get a little bit of that vibe going right now. I actually, speaking of creative things, no one jacked this idea for me, but I was talking to one of my friends, and she mentioned that in this hospital near, I should really do this with the coronavirus situation, but my friend was saying that they opened up, there's this like fancy coffee shop in my town, and they opened up one of these, like a branch of this fancy coffee shop in the hospital. So like in the first floor of this hospital, there is this like oddly, like, you know, it's kind of like a, what's the word I'm looking for? Not amateur. It's kind of like a, not a chain, but like trying to be like a chain, I guess you could say. So they opened this coffee shop in the first floor of this hospital. And I was like, wow, a coffee shop in a hospital would be such a good setting for one of my comics. That is such a weird overlap where like you're serving coffee in this kind of like barista environment, but you're actually on like the first floor of a hospital. I'm moving this water thing. I don't want to move my hand in front of the camera every single time. Whoa, camera moving. So yeah, that also has that like 3 a.m. gas station supernatural vibe. What do we call that? What's the name for that? That really needs a name. It's almost like numinous. It's not really numinous because it's not like scary. But it has that feeling for sure. And what I'm thinking right now is I'm going to paint in this table, and the burnt umber is going to be really dark when it dries. So when I paint over it with the lines, I might need to use a light color. But let's just see how it goes. I'm just going to go in. Oh, man. I'm also trying to go a little faster. That does not mean that I'm rushing. Obviously, I Oh, I hope you guys can hear the birds outside. It's so loud. That does not mean that I'm rushing, but it does mean that I'm just thinking about the scope and the scope of the details and how that plays out. I could spend, 3 hours on a painting this size, or I could, spend less time. I just, personally, I actually kind of like doing the, 2.5 hour ones. That's just the natural length they ended up being. I actually never planned on them being that long. But I just think it's kind of intimidating. Like, if you're going through YouTube and you want to watch a video and then you see this, 2.5 hour long thing, it's kind of a lot. So I would like it to be shorter, ideally. But I also want it to be interesting, and there's not that much I can really get done in an hour. So it's going to see how it goes. Eventually, if they keep being 2.5 hours, I'll have to, figure something out. But for now, I'm kind of still in an experimental phase. Should I lighten up the bottom of the table so the top looks different than the bottom? Yeah, I should. For that, perfect. I'm going to throw in this raw umber here. Dun, 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 dun. Cool. And painting, it's funny because when I first started, you never really think about the browns. I'm going to break my own rule right now and mix paint with the brush. If I was like your art teacher and saw you doing this, I'd be kind of pissed, but I guess I'm a little bit of a hypocrite. So yeah, when I first started painting, I never thought the browns would be like much of a thing. Like, you get your art list from the art teacher, whether you're at like a college or whether you're just studying somewhere near you, and they tell you what to go get. And there's like 5 browns on this list. And I'm like, are you serious right now? But they all actually are really different. And when I don't have one, I get so mad. Because if you need like burnt sienna, there's no way to approximate it. There's nothing that that is like that color. None of the pigments are interchangeable. Cool. So we're getting this down in here. I'm also kind of excited because I took a little bit of a detour in my studies. Talked about that last week a little bit, but I'm always making like really big circles in terms of what I'm reading and what I'm looking at. And I did a little bit of a detour into kind of like academic aesthetics world, and that kind of took me into like Marxism and its influence on, all these like kind of like meme philosophies. I think of them as meme philosophies, where it's just people like kind of, frankly, I think, pretending to like understand these like really complicated terms that don't really mean anything. And I was in that world for a little while, and I was listening to these talks about it while I was like cleaning my house and reading some books I haven't looked at in a while. And eventually I just got kind of sick of it, and I was like, all right, I'm gonna stop playing around and go back to theology world. So I feel pretty good about that. I got this huge Thomas Aquinas book from this used bookstore. It's massive. I actually can't wait to hit that. Okay, so wall. This is drying. I'm gonna kind of just intuitively like build this image up. And we were talking about it a little bit. I think I'm gonna throw kind of like a coffee cup down on the table right here. And I gotta decide what color to make that. I really just feel like it should be red. I could pick a different color, but that was what my intuition said, so let's just go with it. So this is not the red that I normally use. The red that I normally use is cadmium scarlet. That's a little bit more orange. That's the warmest color in my palette. Here, this is cadmium red. So this is a really, really standard red. I don't have autofocus on. I'll have to adjust for that. It's called cadmium red. Any palette that you get from anyone is gonna probably have cadmium red in it. You really need that to do pretty much anything. It's one of the more expensive colors. It's also why I'm wearing gloves. If you've watched this before, you know that, but cadmium is like a really dangerous metal, but it's the only way to get this nice color, so there you go. And I'm just gonna throw this kind of like graphic. So here I have a little bit of a decision. I should get some white in here to chalk up this color a little bit, make it a little bit more chalky. Should I do it or should I just throw it down straight? I really can't tell. I think if I put it down straight, it's gonna be a lot more painterly. And if I get the white in and chalk it up, it'll look a little bit more illustrative. I really can't tell what to do. I am just gonna go for it. Let's just go for it. I'm also, just for the record, not like being indecisive there. I kind of just also want people to hear my thought process, so. You can see what I'm thinking when I'm doing this. Let's just throw this down. Perfect. So you can also see one of the main, if you want to start getting like advanced, I guess you could say, and how you are thinking about art and responding to art and things like that. One term, you know, it sounds like one of these pretentious kind of art terms, but it actually does mean something and it is really important, is how the artist is engaging with the picture plane. So what that means is you have this two-dimensional surface here. Oh, I'm loving the camera situation. This is dope. So you have this two-dimensional paper, right? And every artist, every painter, is working on a two-dimensional surface like this. I mean, sure, you could find some weirdo like painting on a sphere, but let's just like disregard that for a second. All painters pretty much are working on a two-dimensional surface. And the question is how they're using that two-dimensional surface in terms of, you know, is it a window into three-dimensional space? Is it totally flat? Is it like in human perspective? Is it not? And that's one way you can start kind of leveling up like your art analysis, honestly. So here, for example, that handle came out all right. I really wanted to make sure it looked like a handle because you can't see the top of the coffee cup. It's actually what I was going for, talking about the picture plane. Here I've chosen this like hyper 2D on-looking view. So like you can't see the top of the table. You can't see into the coffee cup. What I could have done is I could have, you know, so you can see that here's the top of the desk, here's the bottom part. I could have put a line back like this and then had it come over to the right and had that be the top of the table, like you'd be able to see the top of it. And then I could have painted in an oval here instead of a straight line, and then you'd be able to see into the coffee cup, and I could get some coffee in there. I don't know, maybe I should have done that, but I didn't. Instead, I decided to go with this very graphic flat view. And there's different advantages for choosing each way of doing it. For example, the reason why I didn't do that, if I went with that 3D view where you could see the top of the table and you could see into the coffee cup, then I have to deal with that for the whole rest of the picture. So that means that when stuff starts getting up here, I have to decide, well, is it all going to be in that view? We actually would call that like orthographic space if you wanted to sound really cool, where it's in perspective, but not really. A lot of architectural renderings are in what's called orthographic space, where you can see like the side of the building and the front of the building and the top of the building. So it's in perspective, but it's not in perspective like in real life. If you're in a room right now, assuming you're not watching this outside, even if you are outside, actually, wherever you are, actually, this will work in any space that you're in right now. There's probably some surfaces, let's say rectangular prism surfaces like books, boxes, shelves, your refrigerator, your countertop. Like if you actually look around the room that you're in right now, some of those things are below your eye level and you can see the top of them. This sounds kind of obvious, but it's also not that obvious when you're making pictures, and you can see the top of them. So if you look around, I can see this book that's below my eye level. I can see the top of it. Obviously my desk is below my eye level. I can see the top of it. My printer is just below eye level. I can see the top of that. But then across the room is my bookshelf, and my bookshelf, the top of it is actually higher than my eye level. So I can't see the top of that. If you look around the room, just gonna pump that one more time, you'll see what I'm talking about. And if I put that perspective into the space here, I would have to deal with that. So let's say I put in the top of the table. Does that mean that when I get up here near the top of the image, that I'm gonna slowly adjust it? So then if I'm painting something near the top, you can't see the top of it? Or am I gonna keep it so you can see the top of all these objects here? That actually really matters a lot. And I didn't want to have to deal with that, honestly. Not to sound lazy, I just didn't want it to be like that kind of picture. Because then if you mess it up, it starts to look kind of weird, and you have to, again, going back to the confidence I mentioned with the sketching, you have to really confidently engage with that perspective change. So, you know, if we got up near the top of the picture and I wasn't really sure, and let's say I put in a window here, which I probably will do, you know, could you see the sill of the window? Maybe not. And then, you know, I thought it would just complicate things too much, so I didn't do that. It's a little perspective talk there. And I don't know what kind of space we're going to be in right now, but I'm going to put in some kind of floor right over here. Part of me wants to put in kind of like a checkered floor. You know, I was talking about that coffee shop in the hospital vibe. Maybe I am going for that vibe, maybe not. But also the last pictures I made, they were very, you know, sacred space, let's say. It was very like sacred space vibe. So why not kind of go on the other end of the spectrum and we'll see how it goes. Okay, So I'm going to throw in this floor over here. I never really use checkered floors in my art, but like I said, I try and do things that I haven't done before on the stream. So I don't know. I don't really know what color to make it. I could make it like dark blue and white. I think I'm going to make it light blue and white, just because one thing you want to think about when you're making images like this is contrast. And the contrast is one way. Hold on, I'm just moving a few things around here. I really don't want my brush to roll into the paint because it's so annoying. Cool. The contrast and the level of contrast is, I can't open this, man. It's really hard to open. There we go. Is basically how you are letting the viewer know what's important in the picture. That's also something that it takes new people making art a while to figure out. So I'm going to say that again. The contrast and contrast level is how you tell the viewer what's important in the picture. So if you imagine, you know, if you're making a picture, I feel like I should get a pen out for this. Actually, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it real quick. I have these note cards here just for this purpose. So let's say over here, for example. So this actually happens a lot if you're in like a figure drawing class or you're working with people that are just starting drawing or whatever. Let's say, you know, someone's drawing a picture. I should have used the pencil, but it's fine. Someone's drawing a picture. This is going to be I'm going to make this like comically bad so no one thinks that I'm like trying too hard. Perfect. Yes, look at this anatomy lesson going on right now. Perfect. So you're drawing in the picture and, you know, you got this person's face and the light's probably on their face. Let's say it's a girl. Look, beautiful girl with the hair flowing back. So long. And then let's say, you know, you got her foot back like this. She's doing some kind of weird pose just for the purpose of illustrating this. Why not? Whatever. This is perfect. And someone's drawing this. So imagine this is like some figure drawing you spent a lot of time on, maybe in like charcoal or pencil or something. And there's no real intense shadows on her face. Normally, you know, that's like a thing beginners do often. You know, she's smiling, so happy. And what they'll do is they'll take these spots where there's like cast shadows. Like here you can see her leg comes in front of, her leg in the front comes in front of the leg that's behind her. Relatively, in terms of drawing, that is kind of an advanced thing to do, is having like perspective and things in front of other things. Not advanced, but I mean, you know, you're not just drawing a ball on a table anymore. You have a thing in front of another thing. And what people will do is they'll say, okay, this leg's in front of this leg. There's a shadow here. I got to make this really dark. I'm going to make this really dark so people know that this leg is in front of this other leg over here. And here's where her foot meets the ground. Oh, I looked at Owen's still life drawing tutorial, and he said that where there's cast shadows like this, it's really dark, and they put it in really, really, really dark. Well, if you have a picture like this, and let's say the highest contrast ends up being in one of these weird places, this happens all the time. Or maybe there's like, you know, a plant over here, and the same thing, they're like, oh, I gotta make the shadow behind the plant like really dark. When someone looks at a picture like this, these areas of high contrast, where there's the lightest light against the darkest dark, that's what I mean by contrast, by the way, is the level of lightness versus the level of darkness. That's like a big neon sign telling the viewer's eye, yo, look over here. This is the most important part. So the eye is going to naturally see these areas of high contrast and think that they're important and go there. And that's like a really, frankly, it's like a newbie mistake that people make all the time, putting the areas of high contrast where it's not the most important. If this was like, you know, a portrait of someone, you would want the areas of highest contrast to be near the face, because, you know, the face is probably like the most important part of the picture if you're doing a portrait, right? And then when you're looking in real life, even if there was something over here that was like super dark, you wouldn't make it that dark. You would just make it like a little dark because you're composing the picture. That was kind of a detour, but the reason I took that detour was because if I'm putting down a checkered floor over here, I don't want it to be like black tiles, like black tile versus white tile, because it's going to draw your eye like a magnet and say, hey, over here, look at this area of high contrast. So for that reason, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to make a rookie mistake on the stream right now. And I hate that I'm doing this. I'm setting a bad example, but I am just going to mix a little paint with my brush right now. Actually, I shouldn't have done that. It's fine. I'm going to use the palette knife. Perfect. And I had that reaction because I realized I would need a little bit more than I thought I would. And if you're mixing it with the brush, it's really, really, really inaccurate. And inevitably, you're not going to have as much paint as you need. So I'm going to mix it with the palette knife instead. I feel like the camera's a little tilted. Let's fix that. Perfect. Cool. I wonder if anyone's actually started painting based on this. I am going to do, I think, a few more introductions like to less expensive like materials and things that you can jump into right off the bat. Watercolor pencils is something else I want to hit that people could easily start out with. So maybe in the beginning every time I'll do like some like plausible thing you can like start doing. Cool. All right. I'm also getting used to just like speaking live and like going off the top of my head when I do this. I used to, this isn't too much like, I can't talk too much about my old jobs, but I can a little bit. I used to do, I guess I can call them like public speaking workshops. I think that's what I've called them in the past on here. And it's funny because I used to have people that would say, you know, like all the time or like stutter or be like, you kind of got to give it to them and tell them not to do that. But I find that when I'm thinking as I'm talking, it's very natural because I'm thinking as I'm speaking. So I'm trying to work on that. I could like slow it down a little bit and really think about every single word I'm saying. But honestly, it's just not as engaging then. If I have this like filter and I'm thinking about every word and it becomes a lot slower, it's just less interesting for you guys. So I'll let my ego take the hit. And I'll say things like, and that's just how it's going to be for a little bit. All right. I got this light color here. And this is going to dry darker than it looks over here. That's the rule for these paints. The light colors dry darker than they look. The dark colors dry lighter than they look. Because nothing's ever easy. And I'm going to throw down the floor over here. Perfect. And I'm giving it a little bit of a loose feel. I'm not too worried about how it's going to look. This is kind of like sketching painting. Cool. Yeah, you can see. Look how much darker it already is. I don't know if you can tell yet, but it's drying way darker. Over here. Perfect. And here I have another decision to make. Yeah, I could break out the little brush, but I'm not going to do it. Perfect. Perfect. Let things be a little loose. Why not? I make perfect stuff all the time. So here I have another decision. Am I going to make these lines angled or am I going to make them vertical? I really don't like the idea of making them vertical. I think that's like, I don't know, for some reason it reads as like a little cheesy to me. I don't know why. So I'm going to put them in at an angle. It's also funny, you know, if you start doing this a lot, you realize you have all these kind of like illogical associations with things. Like when I thought about putting the lines in vertical, I was like, oh, I'm not going to do that kind of picture. But what does that even mean, like that kind of picture? All right. Boom. Boom. Perfect. This one's going to be a little bit sketchier, but I'm cool with it. I want to see how it goes. All right, I'm gonna color in these tiles. Let's see how far we are. I have no idea. Like it's gonna be like an hour already or something insane. Wow, it's freaking 50 minutes already. That's insane. It's completely insane. All right, so I'll take some questions, I guess, while I'm digging in over here, painting these tiles in. If anyone wants to ask me anything, yeah, like Peter M just did, if you write at Owen Cyclops, it's highlighted in red. And I can see it way easier. That makes it 10,000 times more likely for me to see your question. Oh, you guys are getting lag? That sucks. Getting lag on video, but not audio. Yeah, I have this little square in the corner that says how good it's going, and it goes from green. It's green right now, but sometimes it goes red. Let me know if you're getting lag. Hey, it's red again now. Maybe I'll close other programs. I mean, I don't have anything crazy open, but I'll close the other stuff. If anyone has like any tips, if anyone streams a lot and they know how to like reduce all that stuff, let me know. I'm gonna close the other windows I have open. Anything else that would like cause lag? Nah, I think we're good. I think we're good. Okay. Eventually, if it comes down to it, I'll see if my wife is watching Netflix. But let's see if it gets to that point. Okay. What are some good books about Catholicism, especially the Virgin Mary? Honestly, man, as much as I love being like theology boy. I really am amateur theology boy, so I'm not really the person to ask, like, about specific books for things like that. So I couldn't really say. I'm in the strange position. It really goes with my, what's the word I'm looking for? I enjoy the mystical fool archetype a lot. I identify with it, sometimes as a joke, but also I actually do in real life. And I'm in this strange position where the religions that I subscribe to the most are not the religions that I've researched the most. It sounds like there's a coincidence there. I'm sure if like I had like atheist haters, they would like clip that or something. But what I mean is more that, you know, I feel very comfortable being like, well, here's the authoritative view on X, Y, and Z. Like, I can go off about like art and aesthetics and stuff, but because of the nature of like a structured like apostolic religion, if someone's like, well, what's the official Catholic view on X? I really wouldn't want to be like misleading people. People ask me that a lot. People will DM me and be like, you know, oh my God, like, what's the official like orthodox stance on this? And I'm like, you didn't read my bio. I'm just a humble painter. Amateur theologian. There's a ton of priests on Twitter. Ask them. So I can't really say. I did pick up a book by a saint, but it's an Orthodox saint. His name's Saint John. I think it's Maximovich, something like that. His name's Saint John. I know him as Saint John of Shanghai and San Francisco. And it's a book on the place of Virgin Mary in the Orthodox Church. So I'm stoked to read that. But Virgin Mary in the Catholic Church, I couldn't say. I do have one here, but I haven't read it yet, so I don't want to recommend it yet, but yeah, can't really say yet. What's your favorite movie right now? That's a really good question, man. Oh, next question. Why is this called fifth episode when there's already a fifth episode? Because I can't count, man. I was going to number the rosary prints today and I realized I had no idea what number I left off on. I mean, I found a piece of paper, so it wasn't a big deal. That's why. It's just a mistake. There should be an esoteric reason, but there's not. My favorite movie? That's really interesting, man. I don't know if I've talked about that on the stream before, but I have a very, like, antithetical relationship with film. Maybe I've talked about it. I can't really tell, honestly. But it's not that I don't like movies, but I just never really got into them. I think I wasn't exposed to them enough as a kid. But I never really got into them. There's a few movies I do like. My favorite movie of all time is probably Akira Kurosawa's Dreams. It really goes with the stream and the colors and everything because Akira Kurosawa was like the preeminent OG Japanese director in my mind. And he made all these really awesome movies that some of you guys have probably heard of that are like seminal Japanese films, but they're all in black and white. And then when he got color film, his first color film is called Dreams by Akira Kurosawa. So it's pretty awesome even just like in a mythology sense because it's this like OG Japanese director transitioning into the world of color for the first time, and it's really awesome. It's really, really, really great. I highly recommend it. So that's probably my favorite movie of all time, actually. Okay, we may get back to the movie question, but here's the real question. How do I want to like set this, the rest of this picture up over here? I kind of want to put like some kind of line over here and have a different floor space going on. Then I could have another desk over here, maybe a door and then a window or something. I might kind of commit to, like, the coffee shop and a hospital feeling. I've been to a lot of, like, medical buildings. I've been to a lot of, like, medical places recently. And it is a really interesting vibe inside. What color is the floor, though? The floor is kind of gray. Am I going to use gray right now? Maybe I am. Yeah, maybe I am. Maybe I'm going to use some gray right now. So here's something interesting that I haven't covered on the stream yet. This is a really interesting principle of color theory. So gray, one thing I could do to get gray, and I guess this would be the most intuitive thing, is to take black, take white, mix them together. Everyone knows that, right? Obviously. But there's another way of mixing grays that is less obvious. I really need a color wheel. I really should have one around here, but I don't. But if you imagine a color wheel, or if you have your phone, you can pull one up. Colors that are opposite on the color wheel will cancel each other out and basically make gray. So for example, if I have a yellow and a purple, those are opposites on the color wheel. If you imagine in your mind mixing yellow and purple, what kind of color you think that you might get, it doesn't really have like a color that it would get to, right? Because those are opposites on the color wheel, they would cancel out and get gray. Yeah, hold on a second, I'm drinking water. So let's see if I can do that. And all the grays are different. The gray that you get for mixing yellow and purple and having those cancel out is going to be different than red and green canceling out, is going to be different than blue and orange canceling each other out. I am going to use blue and orange just because I already have blue on the floor over here, and maybe I can get a little bit of a blue vibe going on. I also don't know if it'll work, so let's see. We'll have a little experiment on the stream right now. I feel like the camera keeps tilting. I will keep an eye on that. So here I have this color. It's cadmium orange. It's like cadmium red, but it's orange. And when I do this, I don't just think of it one-dimensionally where... everyone's getting bad skipping. That sucks. Should I go try to address that? The lag is getting really bad. Okay, one second. I'll be right back. This is intermission. Grab a snack. I'll be right back. Give me like 30 seconds. Let's see. I'm gonna turn my phone off the Wi-Fi. Would that matter? Maybe, maybe not. Let's see. I'm also thinking about upgrading my internet. I do live in the middle of nowhere, so let's see. Damn, I'm still getting this red freaking line over here. Let's see. I think it's good now. I kicked my wife off the internet. Is that trad? I just went in the other room and told her to stop using the internet. That's really funny. That's actually really what I did, though. I'm just going to go for it. Honestly, if it's lagging too much, that sucks, and I'll figure it out. But there's not really anything I can do right now. I'm just going to go for it. I guess if it lags too much, if I upload the stream at the end... would that be laggy too? Does anyone know? How would I know? I have no idea. All right, this is too much dead air. I'm just going to go for it. I'm going to try and just power through, and I don't know. If it's too laggy, my bad. I've done everything I can. yeah, power structure, men are working. Yeah, exactly. All right, so I'm just going to go for it, and then, I don't know, I'll kind of like power through and maybe like speed up a little bit so this won't be like as long, and then if it's laggy and I can't upload it, my bad. I'm really good at painting and graphic design. I'm not good at video internet yet, so. This is true, by the way. This is true. I promised 3 a.m. public access TV quality, and that's what you're really getting right now. Other people say they're going to deliver amateur quality. No one does like me. That's a promise. That's a promise to the viewers. No one is really delivering the 3 a.m. public access TV status with the static. I should get some static going on. Anyway though, yeah, I'm not gonna say it again, but if it's too laggy, my bad, and I will work on it, but for now I'm just kind of gonna power through so it's not like 10 minutes of like dead air. All right, so I was talking about mixing gray, and I'll kind of just go a little faster just in case, you know, we'll kind of like, I'll experiment with going faster too, why not. So here I got this orange. I was saying, we're talking about mixing grays, getting back on track, and yeah, when I do that, I don't just think of it one-dimensionally where I'm like, oh, here's orange, I need blue, and mix them together. You have to think about what kind of color it is, because every color you're working with has like a primary and secondary quality, and you want both of those to cancel out. If you're the kind of person that really enjoys cracking out on like RPG, mixing classes, like what type of, I don't know, like Pokemon is strong against another, that is what's going down right now. So this orange is not just an orange, it's kind of like a red orange, I guess. So the color that I mix it with, opposite of orange is blue, opposite of red is green. So I kind of want like a green blue. So I'm gonna use this cerulean blue and see how it goes. Yeah, all I need is VCR warps in the footage. Yeah, for sure. I really do need that. And my cerulean blue is kind of like dried out, honestly. It really sucks. But it's okay because we only need a little bit for right now. All right, let's see how this goes. And I'm going to try and get some gray on the floor. And yeah, you know, I like taking things as blessings in disguise. So this will also just be an excuse for me to try going a little bit faster than normal. Yeah, I see this number dropping in the corner. I can actually, I just realized I can see my kilobytes per second. And it's low. It's very low. What will I do about that, though? No one knows. Right now, maybe nothing. Tomorrow, maybe I'll call the internet situation. You know, it's funny because, oh, this is the perfect hospital floor color. Wow, I'm really excited about that. I should get it more blue, though. They did call me and tell me to upgrade my internet, and I said no, so maybe they're punishing me right now. Yeah, here we go. This is perfect. You can also see, I told you guys never to use your brush to mix colors. You can see why. I'm having difficulty getting it perfectly consistent. There we go. Nice. And I want to lighten this up a lot because I don't want it to be so dark. Gonna cut in with some white right here. Perfect. Great. Cool. Yeah, you know, it's funny. Someone said like VCR aesthetic, like kind of like a vaporwave thing going on. I was Photoshopping up before, and sometimes when I just can't, when I can't do any more work, you know, like I said, I'm literally in the studio like all the time, like 24/7. I don't know if I want it to be this dark. It's still really dark. You know, if I'd been paying attention to myself, I mentioned on an earlier show, it's really easy to darken colors. It's really difficult to lighten them. So now I'm trying to lighten this. It's probably not going to work, but I'm going to mix some more white in, and then I'm just going to roll with it. Yeah, so someone mentioned VCR aesthetic, like vaporwave situation. Sometimes, so when I can't draw anymore, when I just can't work anymore, you know, I wake up like pretty early. I get up at like 7. That's not hyper early, but I don't wake up late. And then I just come in the studio and start working, and then I just work like all day. Like some days I'll just work until like 9, 10 or so, and then go to my room, talk to my wife for like a half an hour and fall asleep. It's like my life a lot. Not that I'm complaining. And sometimes when I just can't work anymore, but I want to like keep being productive in some way, you know, I don't really like goofing off hardcore. I guess you could say I have a mode I call like low productivity, where I'm doing something that is not productive, but also not like 100% goofing off. I'm just going to go for it. All right, so since I don't know if the stream is lagging or not, I'm just going to go for it. And this will also be, like I said, an excuse to see what happens if I go a little faster. So who knows how this will turn out, but we're just going to go for it. So I have a mode I call like soft productivity, where I'm like doing something that is kind of productive, but not really. And what I do sometimes, I've never posted any of this, I've thought about it, but I've been Photoshopping things where it's like vaporwave, but what if vaporwave was blank instead of blank? So like, what if vaporwave was like Korean instead of Japanese? Like, what if all the Japanese influence was Korean instead of Japanese, you know? Or things like that. Like, what if instead of like 80s tech, it was like even further back? And I'll just make these kind of like fun, like aesthetic, like exercises. And today I was doing that, the Korean thing, and I actually made some pretty dope stuff, and I was gonna post it, but then I was like, I feel like people are gonna think that I'm shilling for like the Korean government or something. So I used a bunch of these really aesthetic photos I have of North Korea that I have saved on my computer, obviously essential. Boom. But I like doing kind of like aesthetic exercises like that. You know, like everyone has their own aesthetic. I obviously have mine. But it's kind of interesting to branch out and just like pretend like, oh, what if, you know, kind of like aesthetic experiments, you can say. That's what I do in my sketchbook a lot. All right, here we go. Boom. All right, so I got this gray in here. And I'm kind of trying to decide what I'm going to have opposite this. I feel like I should just have like another desk. I could put a person there, but that really changes the quality of the picture. Kind of don't want that. And I'm going to have to go back in and like tighten up the outline of the cup and stuff, but I'm not going to do it. Cool. Shilling for DPRK. Yeah, tell me about it, dude. Hey, if they paid me. No, I'm just kidding. Maybe a little though. But Yeah, I joke about it's totally a joke. Oh, I can talk about this here because I'm not on Twitter. I joke about, you know, the Juche. Juche is like North Korean ideology. And I made this like aesthetic flag for like American Juche and stuff. And someone actually DM'd me. They were like, do you actually like subscribe to like the North Korean political ideology, or is this just a joke? It's like, dude, it's a joke, obviously. Okay, so what am I going to do now? The thing is, what I would normally do... Yeah, the lag's still here. My bad. I'm just going to power through. There's nothing I can do now. I closed all my other programs, but I'm just going to roll with it. I'll try and like wrap this up quickly, I guess. But is there anything in the options? Oh, dude, wait. Can I stream at like a lower rate? Can I stream at like a lower... Because I have it on like super mega high quality. Maybe that would help. Would that help? We're about to transition fully into like amateur me just like fucking around mode, but oh shit, I can adjust the video bit rate. I don't know. Should I do that? I really can't tell. Really can't tell. Are you enjoying the thrill of live video broadcasting right now? I hope you guys are. Should work. Yeah, the thing is, it's kind of weird because I thought there would be like settings, but I can adjust the now we're officially all just like hanging out. Now we're just all chilling together. I can adjust the video bitrate, but it's by like one number at a time. It's at 2500 and I can just click this down arrow and take it to like 2499. I feel like there should be some like preset numbers there. So Oh, I could stream at a lower resolution, but then I have to stop. Then I have to stop doing it. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to stop and restart. That's way too much. Okay, let's do it. All right, so if anyone's watching this and they were really expecting like professional painting show quality, it's not happening right now. We're all just officially hanging out right now. I am going to lower the video bitrate. We're at 2,500. Should I cut it in half? Is that too extreme? Maybe I shouldn't cut it in half. Error. YouTube's not receiving enough video to maintain smooth streaming. Oh my God. Everything is going belly up right now. Oh my God. I'm panicking. No, I'm not really panicking. Yeah, I'm just going to cut the stream bitrate in half. Why not? I have no idea what I'm doing. Let's just try it. I'm going to put this at, I really have to click the arrow and bring it all the way down. That's absurd. Let's see how it goes. Dun, 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 dun. It's making me click the arrow. That's unreal. I really can't just like, oh, here we go. I'm going to put it at 1300. Let's just see how it goes. Let's see. I put it at 1300. Stream health. Yeah, cut it in half. Yeah. All right. Excellent. It says stream status excellent right now. I don't know if that means how many people are watching. YouTube says that, not me. It says stream health excellent. So we're just gonna... Yeah, the graph. It's the graph. This is graph stream. Yeah, that's funny, actually. All right. I think that helped, maybe. I'm gonna go back to painting and then... Let me know. I'm going to look at the chat. Let's see how it goes. I'm glad I have the crew here to bounce ideas off of. And hey, you know, if this if it totally doesn't go well, then I won't keep this one on YouTube. And then you guys will have this. It'll be exclusive. Just me and you guys hanging out situation right now. Okay, so I'm just going to officially like wing it. Just see how things go in the painting situation. The stream is definitely excellent now. Yeah, nice. Okay, so I was trying to think whether I should throw in a door or like a window or what. I'm going to put in a door, put in a window, put in a desk. No. We'll see what else happens right now. Maybe I'll put something outside the window. I feel like we're just rolling totally into crazy territory. We don't know how the stream's going. The painting is going good, obviously, because I'm doing it. It seems to have worked. Cool. All right. So yeah, I'm just gonna throw in these like dark glass doors. Let's see how it goes. Since I feel like we're all hanging out, I feel like I've been looking at the chat for a while. If anyone wants to ask me anything, we can talk about whatever you guys want. And this will be experimenting with the bitrate stream, the official techno adjustment stream. Perfect. And I want to get these kind of like dark glass doors going on. Perfect. And make them a little higher. It's funny because often I feel like I like to play with the sense of scale in my pictures, but if there's a door that kind of like really limits, not limits, but it delineates, it delimits exactly how tall people would be if they were in the scene. So I got to kind of make sure I pick a good height for the door. And the color I'm putting in is indigo. I've mentioned this before, but I really like indigo as kind of like a proxy for black. It isn't black, but it's so dark that within the color realm, it almost looks black. So that's the color I'm throwing in right now. Seems to have worked. Didn't tweet out a stream reminder earlier in the day and forgot it was tonight. Yo, that's true. My bad. I gotta do that. I am... The funny thing, so like, the funny thing about running the whole art studio situation, and like, not to sound LARPy, like that literally is like all I do. Like, I wake up in the morning and then boom, I'm on thinking about the art stuff I'm going to do. And then when I'm going to bed, it's like what I'm thinking about lying awake in bed. So the funny thing about it is like there's always like something that you forget to do. And I feel like anyone, I mean, it's like a small business I run, you could say. I know other people have more like legit small businesses where they have like employees and stuff. But yeah, I think the funny thing about it is like you kind of just have to accept like that you're going to do like all these things wrong. Like I started, you know, first like selling shirts and like doing commissions like maybe like 2 years ago. It was longer than that, actually. And I've only just gotten to the point where I'm not like aggressively fucking it up all the time. And it's so funny. I imagine anyone that does any like business thing on their own, like there's always like a, oh yeah, I really should do that. Like the last time I did, you know, a shipment of something, like I didn't tell anyone when I was going to ship it or anything like that. So yeah, you get used to making mistakes and just rolling with it. I got some paint on my gloves, so I'm going to change my gloves real quick. Okay, where did I put the box of gloves? Cool. All right, well, thanks for being here for the amateur stream, guys. We're in amateur mode right now, but sometimes that's good. It's kind of like Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind, if you guys have read that book. It's like if you're always a beginner, then, you know, you have the beginner's mindset. You're not limited in what you think can happen. I'm going to grab some water, too. Ah, cool. All right. So, nice. Lots of good questions. Oh, my God. My glove ripped. Is it like a full moon? Is it like Friday the 13th? It's cool, though. All right. Cool. Am I a fan of Doug Tenapel? You know, actually, I don't know who that is. Maybe that's embarrassing. I'm not sure who that is. But if he's cool, let me know. Thoughts on the Amish? There's a question, man. The Amish are really cool. obviously, it appeals to my kind of like primitive anti-civilization, prepare for the collapse nature. I did look into their theology at some point. Obviously, I would do that, right? And it's based on this guy. I think the guy's name was like Joseph Ames or something, so they're called the Amish. It's something like that. I always group the Amish with the Mennonites, but I actually think the Amish are a little bit cooler than the Mennonites. There are a lot of Mennonites near where I live. That's not too specific. There's Mennonites everywhere. And I've been to some places with a lot of Amish. What's funny about the Mennonites and the Amish is that the Amish are like more hardcore. I think that's why I respect them more. I watched this documentary about these Mennonites, and they moved to Mexico. I think it was in like the 1800s. So all these Mennonites moved to this part of Mexico where they just can't farm using the old techniques. So they started just... So the whole doc is like presented that way, where it's like, how are these Mennonites gonna deal with the fact that they can't use these the techniques they're supposed to use in this place? And I was all amped. I was like, oh man, what are they gonna do? But then in the documentary, they're like, they just have meetings and they're like, yeah, let's just use modern stuff, like whatever. And then eventually they start using like modern tech and everything. And I don't know, I was kind of like, made me like them less. Not that I'm hating. I mean, I'm using like hardcore tech to stream all this stuff, so they're more hardcore than me. But yeah, the Amish are cool. There's a place called what's it called? I think it's called Sweetwater, Ohio, where there's a ton of Amish people, and it's still kind of like Swiss cultured a little bit there. I think the world's largest cuckoo clock in the world is there, and you can get all this like Swiss food and stuff there. But the Amish are pretty cool. If anyone hasn't seen the population charts of the Amish population growing insanely rapidly, you should definitely check it out. There's some GIF people have seen where people have posted where it's like on one side it's the Amish, on the other side it's the Mormons, and they're just like rapidly spreading out of their like population centers. And yeah, I don't have much more to say than that. I mean, they're Protestant, so not that I'm not saying it like it's a bad thing, but you know, as far as like the fundamentals of like what they believe, I feel like it's like Protestants who are skeptical of modern civilization, right? That's pretty much it. I went through a phase of watching a lot of docs on the Amish and stuff like that. There's one really good one. I forget what it's called, but maybe I'll find out what it's called and post it on Twitter. Where these British teenagers come to America and live with these Amish kids, but then the Amish kids go to Britain and live with the British teenagers. And there's this one scene, I really wanted to clip it and post it on Twitter, but I didn't, where one of these Amish teenagers gets taken to some like dance class, and these like hyper urban kids are doing this rap hip hop dance for them. And the girl's face, you can tell that her immediate reaction is like, wow, this is extremely demonic. And she's extremely disturbed from watching this like really angular, aggressive, like sexual dance. And just seeing the disturbed look on her face was very validating in some ways. Conversely, in the same show, what I'm thinking right now as I'm arranging this, just so people know what I'm thinking, I'm going to kind of like power through this since, you know, we got to like talking and, you know, whatever. I just feel like, you know, the stream's kind of taking like a certain direction, which I'm cool with. I'm going to put like a desk over here. I really should have put the desk on this side so it wouldn't be mirrored with this kind of like desk area over here. But let's see. I also suspect that what's going to happen is as I'm blocking in these elements, it'll kind of look a little disjointed. But then when I go back in, I'm going to put like some smoke off the coffee or something like that. It'll start to like come together a little bit more. But I suspect that like as I power through this next part, it'll start to look kind of weird, and then I'll like bring it back together. For this desk in the back, I'm going to use this color called Raw Sienna. So yeah, conversely, it was really interesting because in the same doc, they had, when the British kids went to go live with the Amish kids, there were some of the girls who really, really, really responded to the way that the Amish girls were living. And it was really interesting. You know, a big part of like what I'm interested in general is just seeing people's psychology and how they react to different worldviews and things. And yeah, when some of these girls saw how the Amish date, I don't know if you guys know, but how the Amish date, I mean, I'm sure it's not all the same, but in general, what a lot of the Amish do is, they have like a room in their house. It's like a courting room where young men will come over, and the young man and whoever's like, I guess the oldest daughter or whatever, whoever's in the process of like being courted, they'll just hang out in this room and they'll talk and get to know each other. Obviously they would never like touch each other or make out or something because they're Amish. And that's how they do it. And it was interesting because you could see these like young modern girls who are used to like going to clubs and like hooking up with people. And when the Amish girls explained this, you could see that a few of the girls had the realization where they were like, wait, that's awesome. Like, you have these guys come here and they court you and you guys like get to know each other. And they would talk about having casual sex with the Amish girls. And that's the other interesting thing. Like, you know, I feel like what modern society would want you to think, and I'm sure this is the case in some places, is that they're forced. I don't want to use the word forced because, of course, if you're in a social structure, it's kind of arbitrary to say whether you're forced into it or not. This color is a little too, I don't know, foody. It's not really the color I want. So I'm going to grab some of this burnt umber that I have over here, or this is the raw umber actually, and mix it in just to make it a little bit more like wood color. And yeah, what was interesting is the Amish girls were like, oh, I would never want to do that. Like, what? They were blown. Their minds were totally blown that these young girls were going out and like hooking up with guys like in clubs and stuff. They were like, what are you guys doing? Are you serious? And just seeing that interaction happen where, of course, it's like a very cliche talking point, but where like, you know, our culture would have us say like, this person's oppressed or this person isn't oppressed. And seeing that interaction play out in real time was really interesting. There's a lot of docs like that. You know, it's kind of like an easy, like, reality TV thing to do is have modern people hang out with the Amish and switch it around. But, yeah, they're pretty cool. That's my long answer. They're also, let's see, do I have anything else to say about the Amish before I keep it moving? Not really. I wish I knew more about them, but not really. People, actually, I will say this, it's kind of funny. My wife and her friends, like, they dress in, like, a very particular way. It's nothing weird, just kind of, like, normal, traditional, is that what I would call it? Like, they wear, like, dresses and stuff like that. And there's all these, like, Pentecostals and Mennonites and people in my town that, I guess they're Mennonites, really. And it's really funny because the people I work with, they asked me if my wife was, like, a Mennonite or something. She always wears these nice dresses when she comes to, like, pick me up. And I was like, yo, I'm down with this assumption. Hell yeah, dude. And then we were at another store. I don't know if I posted about this on Twitter. And one of these Mennonite girls complimented what my wife was wearing. And I was like, yes. Epic trad compliment right now. Getting compliments from these, like, Mennonite girls. Perfect. This is exactly the vibe we need. Anyway, that's enough on the Amish. I don't really know much about them, honestly. Whatever designs something for a government contract, official Owen Cyclops symbols or something, do you work for the government? Do you want to do that? Yeah, I mean, I would be down. I wouldn't say no. I mean, if it was like a CIA logo or something, I guess I'd have to think about it, but I feel like the camera's moving, or am I bumping it? I can't really tell. Yeah, I would do that. Why not? I mean, I'm a reasonable level of skeptical of the government, but I also have this, like, obviously patriotic streak. So, yeah, I would definitely be down. I do think about how to modern manifestations of the American aesthetic and how it's going to look for us moving forward. So, yeah, that would be really interesting for me. That's something else that I want more people working on, too, is helping out with that, because we are going to need to make more badass the American aesthetic. Whatever the direction is moving forward, that's, like, really going to need to happen. Okay, so I am going to throw down a color on this wall over here. Since I'm not really thinking about it too much, I'm kind of just trying to, like, wing it and go for it and see what happens. I'm going to use yellow. I almost want that feeling of, like, sickly, like, yellow lights, since I guess this painting ended up being, like, kind of, like, inside a hospital. So let's see how it goes. Let's see how it goes. And since, like, 20 minutes of the stream was me, like, messing with the video, which was a good time, made me feel like I was, like, hanging out with you guys, I don't know if I'll leave this one up on YouTube. Let's see how it goes. So this could be, like, exclusive secret episode that does not get published. Let's see how it goes. And for that reason, I'll just take more questions. I want it to be, like, fun for you guys also, so. And fun for me. I like feeling like I talk to you guys. On Twitter, it's, like, almost like a forum, you know, where I'm not, like, directly interacting with you guys. So I'm going to throw down this color, and I intentionally used this yellow. It's called lemon yellow. And I'm going to say that, you know, I always say the colors I'm using, so you guys know. It's this very cold yellow. It's very, very cold, as opposed to the other yellows I have that are more warm, because I wanted that cold light feeling. Sort of like a fluorescent light. Those are blue, but if I painted it in blue, I don't think it would really read as a fluorescent light. So maybe it's too yellow, but let's just see how it goes. How excited are you that the aliens or demons theory is gaining traction? Dude, I'm amped. I'm really excited about that. Yeah, it's really interesting. I don't know if we've talked about this on here. I always lose track of, like, what we talk about. But, yeah, I remember, when did I live in my apartment in undisclosed location? Like 2 years ago, maybe 2.5 years ago. You really had to dig for the aliens or demons thing. I mean, I was, like, aggressively consuming. I mean, I still am. This is still what I do. But I was aggressively trying to find the most fringe and crazy ideas possible for, like, hours a day. I mean, I do it now still, but not for hours a day. And I had to dig really hard to get to the aliens or demons thing. And when I found out about it, it was really mind-blowing. I really had never considered anything like that before. So now that it's becoming more normalized, I love it, man. I love it. And that process, people really don't notice, I think, when that happens. Just in general, things becoming normalized, ideas becoming normalized. Because it happens kind of under the radar. Like, I don't know what it's like for other people who you know, maybe just became aware of it, if they see it as something that just popped up, or if they feel like they're just like late to the party, I really have no idea. But yeah, it's really great. I found out out about that through Orthodox writers. There was an article some bishop or someone wrote called, I think it was actually called The New World Order versus the Orthodox Church. And the subheader of the article was, in order for the New World Order to succeed, they must break the spine of the Orthodox Church. And it was this metropolitan, this bishop, I actually don't remember who it was now, it was even before I got into Christianity, writing about how, because the New World Order is like spiritually breaking different populations, that now it was focusing on Russia and Eastern Europe. And I mean, that's his perspective, that's where he lives, you know. So, but it was really interesting, and in there he like casually mentioned the aliens as spiritual idea, like it just was like dropped in, like, oh yeah, by the way, aliens too. And it really caught my eye. I was like, whoa, what's this guy talking about? Someone turned me on to Seraphim Rose. That's when I got into him also. And that's a big part of Orthodoxy and the Religion of the Future. In case anyone hasn't read that, it's like hardcore 101. And yeah, I hit that really hard. And like I said, that was even before I got into Christianity. It was a while ago. It was years ago. And yeah, now it's becoming mainstream. It's interesting too, because I feel like I have a pretty good readout on how things are breaking in society in general. And last year when I wrote that thread, I made a really long thread about aliens and demons, in case anyone hasn't seen it, about aliens as demons. There was just something in the back of my mind that was like, yeah, it's time. Like, I'm going to post this thing I've been thinking about for so long. And I made this, like, I think it was like 200 tweets. It was really absurdly long. I should have just written it on my website, but I didn't. And then, like, 2 days later, Alex Jones went on Joe Rogan and was talking about it. So I don't think he read my thread or anything, but... there's just something in the air sometimes. You can feel that an idea is really ready to break. When I've talked about that with normal people, though, I'd be interested if anyone else has broached that subject with normal people. That's something where they're like, yo, what are you talking about? Like, this is completely insane. Like, with my friends, I did bring it up, like, a little bit. You know, I was like, hey, I have this theory and I want to tell you guys. I feel like it's just too many pieces for them. I also tried to tell my female cousin, and she's into like fringe ideas, but I don't know. I feel like she wasn't really getting what I was saying. I could have been explaining it poorly, but yeah. Okay, so eventually I'll put like a shine in the doors to kind of marry this color. It's a good like kind of sickly color. Let's see how it goes though. Okay, so I'm gonna work now. So you could see that when I'm working, I went from foreground to background. Now I'm gonna go backwards and come up and put the details in the back and build up the details up to the front. Then we'll see how it goes. Let's see, the lag is back. Yeah, that sucks. I can't do anything about that though, but I feel bad. Christian comic author, he did Earthworm Jim. The guy that did Earthworm Jim is Christian? That's insane. I'm definitely gonna look into that. Mennonites are always at my local Costco buying tons of stuff. That's dope. I'm looking for more questions. Okay, here we go. Here's a bunch of them. Yeah, esoteric episode. Yeah, it probably will be esoteric episode. Not that there's anything wrong with it, but, you know. Maybe I'll upload it, maybe I won't. We'll see how it goes. What physical tools do I use for digital art? I used a tablet by a company called Wacom. W-A-C-O-M. Some people pronounce that name differently, but that's how I say it. I'm going to put in these starlights out here. I'll probably put a moon or something out here, too. The tablet's actually really, really, really old. It's from when I was like 16, so I can't say exactly how old that is, but it's from a really long time ago, and it still works perfectly. I don't even think they make it anymore. It's called an Intuos 3, but, if you want to get something, I can't imagine that something from them would not be quality, because like I said, I've had this thing for a heinously long time, and it still works perfectly. And that's all I use. It's not a tablet, so there was kind of like a little psyop within the tech world. Okay, so what I'm thinking about now is I'm going to put some kind of like bushes or trees out here. I'm going to put a little sap green, but the sap green's too light. So I'm going to darken the sap green with some indigo. I'm really going to go for that like sitting in a hospital feeling. I don't know why I ended up painting this, but I've been in a lot of like hospitals recently, and I guess maybe the virus made me think about medical stuff. I have to go to a hospital soon. So... an odd venting of my subconscious and taking in certain aesthetics, let's say. Anyway, yeah, so the tablet, it's not a tablet like an iPad is a tablet. I don't know if people know that there's another device called a tablet. It's like a giant mouse pad. It's a giant mouse pad that you hit with where's my indigo? That you use a pen on, and then that's basically it. So yeah, it's just a giant mouse pad that I use a pen on. That's it. And Photoshop. Do you think you'll open a brick and mortar art shop one day? Wow. Literally never thought about that. Probably not. I know some people that have done something like that. You basically have two routes if you're going to go down that road. You can be a print shop and have a bunch of like printing press stuff. By printing press stuff, you know, you're probably going to have like a litho press and like you're going to do like woodblock prints and you're going to kind of be in like a hipstery part of your city. Not that there's anything wrong with that. It's actually pretty cool running a print shop. And you're kind of going to get by on people ordering like invitations for weddings and people that need like woodcuts done. You're going to kind of get by on like the fact that it's kind of anachronistic. You're going to get by on like the anachronistic nature of making analog prints like that. I know some people that have done that. It's pretty cool, actually. They have one in the city near me. The other option is to be more of like an amalgamator and you run like a kind of cool art store that sells like, you know, just different art from artists in the community and gifts and objects and stuff like that. That's pretty cool too. Recently, it's funny because I moved really far away from when I went to college, but I went to one of those stores, the second kind, where it sells like, you know, paintings done by local artists and things like that in, you know, let's say the Brooklyn of my local city. And I was standing there looking at this painting there, and I was looking at it, and I was thinking, I know the person that did this. I know this person, and I looked at her name, and it was someone I went to college with. It was really funny, and she opened up this store like that. Otherwise, though, no. I mean, if you think about it, the fact that I can use the internet and do my thing on the internet is such a huge advantage that to transfer it into, like, a brick-and-mortar store would just be so heinous. And what do I gain from that? Like, the marginal amount of, like, foot traffic? So short of getting rich or blowing up and making like some kind of like print shop or something, nah, probably not. All right, so I got these bushes out here. I'm gonna put some kind of moon up in the sky. I could use the yellow. I wanted to use like a colored moon because I haven't done that yet. But the thing is that I have the yellow walls and I don't want to tie like the walls to the light coming from outside. Subconsciously, I kind of want to have some like dichotomy between the clear light outside that's nice and like natural and then this like fluorescent light inside. So I'm not going to do that. But in order to keep doing new things and do something I haven't done before, so I'm going to put in this moon. I'm going to make it not really big. I'm going to make it a full moon. There we go. I feel like this indigo paint is like still wet or something. It's coming up so hard, but it's okay. Cool. And I'm going to put in this kind of like moonlight around it. That's what I'm going to do. That'll be something new. Here we go. So this works really well in ink. I haven't really done it with paint, but I'm going to go around and just make this kind of like rings of like moonlight around the moon here. We talked last time about the silvery light of the moon and why it's silvery. And the moon really is one of my favorite symbols. Love it. So dependable to deploy. Cool. Let's get that a little darker even. Oh, I have more indigo right here. Perfect. And yeah, we'll just get some of this like dark light going on. You know, in older like magical texts and in alchemy and stuff, they say that the moonlight is different than the sunlight. That it actually has like a different quality. Modern science says that the moonlight is just reflected sunlight. But there are some people who say you can do experiments and see that the moonlight is actually different than the sunlight. There are some people who will tell you the moon actually emits its own light and it's qualitatively different than sunlight. For example, the sunlight is drying and will like cure things. You know, if you put like fruit out or something, it'll like dry the fruit. Oops, it's a random example. Obviously, it's not that simple. And there's some people that say that the moonlight is putrefying and has a tangibly different effect than the sunlight. Also, in that book, I've mentioned it before on here, At Day's Close, The History of Night. It used to be like in hospitals and stuff, people would write down that the cause of someone's death was going out in a full moon and that the moon has this like, well, it'll make you a lunatic. That's where the word lunatic comes from in case people don't know. Lunar, lunatic, yeah. How long does it go to take to go through a typical pain of tube on average? Really, really, really long time, man. A really long time. I have this pain here. It'll last me a really long time, man. Especially the way that I paint, where it's usually like controlled deploying of paint. It'll take a while. Okay. So I want to get some gray in around the border here. I have this cool gray here. I'm just going to go for it. Let's just, this is like the experimental stream, so I'm just going to go for it. Boom. It's a pretty good straight line, not to jinx myself. Okay, I'm going to put a bar in the middle. Cool. And what I like about this, you know, sometimes, you know, the paintings I've done before, let's say if everything's going perfectly, you get kind of nervous about like making it perfect. Boom. But here, you know, I kind of feel like I'm just sketching with paint, which is really fun. It's something I don't really do very much. So it's a really good time for me. And put in the last bar. Boom. Perfect. Perfect. And I'm kind of trying to decide if I want to get like a parking lot or some kind of thing outside. What I really want to do, I don't know how it's going to look, but I'm going to try it. I'm going to try and put some like headlights in and then to kind of like outline a little bit of a car, like the car is maybe like waiting for someone outside. It's crazy. The whole painting feels sickly and jaundiced now. Yeah, it's kind of what I'm going for, man. Okay. Bump me down to the bottom of the chat. Do you think time is a real dimension or is space-time fake? That's interesting, man. Well, I do... It's a really good question. I'm going to turn this palette over so I can access the other side. Well, so it's 1:40. I want to see what I can do with time, speaking of that question. I'm going to see if I can wrap this up before 2 hours. Let's see how that goes. Do I think space-time is real? Yeah. One of the philosophical things I subscribe to is that time is actually real and that it actually is linear. I think that's a really big difference between Eastern and Western thought. That's not why I think it, but I think that is a big difference. So let's see how this goes if I just paint in these like cadmium yellow lights right here. Like I said, now I'm kind of just like sketching with the paint. So let's see. Could be a mistake, but maybe not. There we go. And I really don't like how like messy that looks, but I think I'm just going to roll with it. And then what I'm going to try and do, this will kick it fully into like a little bit of like a sketch mode, is that I am going to take that indigo color that is the night sky in the background. So this is indigo. And I'm going to lighten it up a little bit, kind of like the moon color I got over there. And then I'm going to paint in an outline with that. And I'll kind of paint in maybe like a street light in the back over there too. And we'll see how that goes. So yeah, I do actually think time is real. To make it a little bit of a theological sense, the thing is that that's kind of what separates Christianity and other ideologies from other ideologies that don't subscribe to this, is that in Christianity, God inserted himself into history as like a historical person, as like a literal figure that existed within the historical timeline. And I feel like that's obviously really important for a variety of philosophical reasons. Hold on, the camera's tilted, man. There we go. Boom. Kinda. There we go. Boom. So yeah, philosophically, it's also not flat. There we go. I feel like that makes a huge difference, and that is something that I, well, that was way thicker than I thought it was going to be. It's fine, though. That does affect my worldview a lot, man, because let's see if what I can get away with here. I'm just going to try like putting it in like loosely. And I'm going to come back over here. So what I'm trying to do is make it look like it's just kind of like the outline of a car. And then I'm going to put like some random shit in the back over here. And I'm kind of just going to put a few lines over here. I just want to imply that there's like stuff outside without fully painting it in. Like I said, this painting is kind of like sketch mode, which I'm cool with. But I want to see what I can get away with. And I'm also going to put kind of like a little street light situation out here. So put this out here. Boom. And yeah, on the time thing, I also do feel like that is part of what separates Western philosophy from other philosophical disciplines, certain views of history and everything. I used to think that time was linear. I used to really be like, I mean, sorry, cyclical. I used to really be one of those people, but now I don't. I think it's a straight line. I think that there is a beginning to the universe that kind of necessitates there being an end to the universe also. And yeah, that definitely affects my ideas and things. Also, that bleeds out into non-theological ideas. Actually, I kind of like how that looks, man. I kind of like how that looks. I was willing to let this whole thing get away from me, but it looks kind of dope. Okay, big choice right now is, do I put something above the door? I kind of want to. I could put like an exit sign, but I hate putting writing in my pictures. I feel like that just makes it kind of like cheesy. Maybe I'll put like a crest or something up there. Not really sure. I'm going to put a computer over here though. Why not? We took it this far on the weird modern aesthetic. So I'm just going to put like a computer over here. Like someone was just working and then they left their computer open. Perfect. Perfect. It's cool going like totally off the rails painting wise. You know, this is totally different from what I normally do, so. Here we go. Perfect. Nice. Do I know any calculus? Does God condemn mathematics? That's really funny. I don't know any calculus. That's actually my only big, huge... All right, I'm going to scroll down to the bottom of the chat now. That was a way earlier question. Just kind of want to see if people are like, a clock on the wall. Yo, good call. So the mathematics thing, that's the biggest regret. Yo, also let me know if it kept lagging. There's nothing I can do about it now, but I kind of just want to know like for my own edification. We're full on test stream mode, so thank you for being here if you are hanging out right now. The mathematics thing, yeah, man, that's one of my biggest regrets from, I'm just going to put like a dot here that represents like the light on the computer. From studying and everything, I could have taken a calculus course at the end of high school, and I didn't, and I really, really, really regret that. It's the one thing where, you know, now that I'm older, I can pretty much pick up whatever I want. Nice, hasn't really been lagging. Nice, nice, nice. Oh yeah, how's the quality once I lowered the bitrate? Could you even tell? Because I have this set on, like, totally insane, like, 100% like HD, but I think that it's actually even too much for YouTube. I don't even think YouTube takes the quality that I'm outputting, and then maybe it has to like, you know, transfer it into like what YouTube will take. That could be a factor. Anyway, the calculus is like the one thing that I feel like I'm not going to be able to pick up on my own. Like at this point, I'm pretty, what's the word for it? Autodidactic. I can pretty much teach myself something if I really set my mind to it. I think probably most of us have some like element like that where you can barely tell a difference word up. Okay, I'll slow down a little bit then if it's working. It's kind of coming out cool actually. Yeah, I feel like most of us are probably like that where if we really put our mind to it, we could probably teach ourselves something if we really wanted to. But the calculus stuff, I feel like it's not going to happen. I feel like it's, for some reason, I feel like it's just like a little beyond, or maybe it's just not the type of thing where I could really buy a book and teach myself it. Maybe I could. Maybe it's more just that I don't want to. But I really wish I had done that in high school. I did take some advanced physics courses, but for some reason, completely unbeknownst to me, they had these like advanced physics courses that were specifically designed so that you could do them without taking calculus. So I just did that instead of taking the calculus ones. And I really regret that. I wish I knew calculus really badly. There is a really cool way that math syncs up with thinking about absolutes, and people say like the mind of God and stuff like that. There's a lot of crazy mathematicians who intersect with theology and talk about how the math intersects with theology. And I do think some of those guys are cool. A lot of the early even like quantum physics people. Oh, mixing with brushes. I know, dude. That's a throw up emoji. A lot of those people are pretty cool. But the thing is, I just feel like it's beyond, not beyond, but maybe it is beyond. I won't be too self-aggrandizing. It's just like beyond what I can really speak to. It's not really my field, but I wish it was. If anyone has anything like on the mathematical side of things like that that they want to send me, go for it. Okay, here we go. I do feel that
physics and my studying physics while I'm talking, while I'm trying to paint this perfect handle right now?
I do feel like physics and my studying physics definitely affected my view of theology and science in general and stuff like that. Because when you study physics, it kind of takes you to this point where, you know, it naturally leads you up to like quantum mechanics and things like that. And there is like the meme popular view of quantum mechanics where people just use it to justify whatever like insane shit they wanted to they want to justify. But there is like an aspect to it where even within like the scientific discipline, it leads to some level of, I don't want to say nuance or uncertainty and like mischaracterize it, but it is really interesting if you get, if you ever get a chance, if anyone's watching this and you have a chance to take like some physics courses, whether on your own or at a college or something, I definitely really recommend it because, yeah, it's just really interesting. I can't really articulate it more than that while I'm painting right now, but, it's a really interesting side of things. Okay. So let's see. What else should I get going on here? I want to start wrapping this up. I'm not sure exactly how it's going to wrap up, but I want to start like getting there. I'm going to throw down some just straight like raw sienna lines to outline the table. One thing that was interesting, since I went on that whole little physics tangent, I would like there to be some like payoff there. Here we go. I can't talk while I'm doing the straight line. Boom, perfect. And just got one more real quick. Boom. There we go. And maybe a little ambitious, but I'm gonna put like a little drawer in here too. Yeah, straight lines. You know I roll with that. Let me get a little ambitious with the sketching and put kind of like a handle in here. Okay, cool. I feel like I should put like a chair or something over here. The painting's kind of like doing itself at this point in the sense that I don't exactly know what's gonna happen, but I'm just rolling with it. So I need burnt umber. I could put in burnt sienna. Ugh, I'm kind of deciding. I'm going to mix the burnt sienna with the burnt umber with the raw umber. Yeah, anyway, so one thing that did give me a totally different view of mathematics was studying physics, because I feel like for years I had been studying, not studying, but I was in math classes and stuff, and I just had no idea why math existed. Honestly, not to sound dumb, but you're taking all these math courses, and the whole time I'm asking myself, like, why? Like, why does this exist? Like, who fucking cares about all this stuff? And I really didn't care at all. And then right near the end of my pre-college studies, I finally took this is a little bit of a risk, but I'm just gonna do it. I finally took physics, and I had this moment of like, oh, this is why math exists. Math exists because you can use it to do all this stuff. And it was really mind-blowing, and I felt really cheated because it was the last year of me studying things in that capacity, and I was like, wow, if I knew about the way in which these things were applied, I would have cared so much. But now it's like I'm on the way out the door and someone's like, oh yeah, by the way, like, here's what imaginary numbers are for, and here's what all this stuff actually does, and here's what you can actually use it for. So if I redid the whole educational system, I would definitely put physics and things like that at the front of it. Oftentimes when I meet people, and you know, a lot of people really hate math, I think that that's why. I think especially, you know, I don't know what the female mind is like. I had women in my physics class. But for young men especially, I think if a lot of them saw the way that you can use all these abstract mathematical concepts within physics, they would get it way more. Okay, I'm putting in this chair. Cool. I like how this is coming out, actually. This is really cathartic, actually, in a weird way, because like I said, I've been spending a lot of time in hospitals, and I never thought I would paint out the aesthetic of one, but I actually really like how this is coming out. I'm really feeling it. I'm gonna put another chair sort of coming in off the side over here. Cool. A hospital is a really weird like liminal place. I guess I will talk about the content that I'm painting in right here. It's a really weird like liminal space. Like I said, I've been in them a lot. I'm not like dying or anything, but I have been in them a lot, and it's such a strange space. It's almost like an airport where people are like coming and going, but it's like a little bit darker than an airport because, oh fuck, I got water on the painting. But it's almost like darker than an airport because everyone there doesn't want to be there, obviously. I kind of like that. That was an accident, but I'm just going to leave it. Got a drop of water on the painting, and then when I blotted it up, picked up the paint underneath. And yeah, there's just something so strange about it. I mean, I guess liminal really is the word for it. All right, when I put this smoke coming out of the coffee, I'm not going to be able to do anything behind there. Maybe the clock on the wall is the move. Some people said that. I think that's actually a really good idea, so I'm going to do that. And yeah, this kind of perfectly, you know, I like when things go full circle on the stream. This really perfectly ties into what I was saying at the beginning, where oftentimes my images will be part of this just like world of like divinity, I guess you could say, where it's, you know, a church on a hill with a sun and there's, you know, an angel or a saint. And I really do like making images that are of that world. Look what I'm doing. Ah, I'm mixing with the brushes again. But yeah, there's something about exploring like the purely mundane realm that really like jumpstarts something in me. I don't know why. Maybe it's because I never do it. Maybe it would be the opposite if I was always operating in this world. Okay, so I'm gonna put down the white. I almost filled up the whole palette. I should put a cross above the doorway. Yo, that's really dope. I would do that, but I don't. It's really tempting. It's really tempting. I don't want to fully kick into that mode. I want to see, you know, we're near the end here. I want to see if I maybe wrap it up with just the mundane situation. Maybe I can get like a subtle reference to that in somewhere. Okay, I'm going to put the clock in up here. Cool. And yeah, the other thing about being in hospitals a lot, since I'm painting one right now, is, you know, it's interesting because like no one wants to be there, right? Obviously. But I think because of that, everyone's like super nice to each other. It's this weird thing where like probably because subconsciously everyone knows that no one wants to be there, that everyone's just really nice to each other. I notice that whenever I go there, like people are holding open doors for everyone and holding the elevator, and I don't know, there's this weird feeling probably of like, oh yeah, like this sucks for me, it must suck for everyone else. I think it kicks in some like higher aspect of people's like nature in a weird way. All right, I'll take some more questions because I think I'm gonna wrap this up soon. My homeschooling my kids or not? Dude, are you serious right now? Of course I'm homeschooling my kids. Oh my god. Yeah, dude, I'm definitely homeschooling my kids. I've been looking into that. Some states are better for homeschooling than others. Some states will let you, you know, do whatever you want more than others. But yeah, I'm definitely homeschooling my kids. I would never send my kids to public school under any circumstances. Conversely, though, there is a weird flip to that where it's like, I want to make sure my kids can operate in society in some capacity. So it's kind of interesting, you know, if you homeschool your kids, they came out a little messy, but whatever. If you homeschool your kids, you know, you are taking on the responsibility for socializing them. But then if you're someone like us, quote unquote, like us, who is a little more skeptical of the general socialization process, it puts you in a weird spot. Because, you know, you could very easily, you know, give your kids the whole truth and nothing but the truth, let's say. But then are they going to be able to, like, go to anyone's house and, like, hang out and, like, be normal? Do you, like, tell them they, like, have to pretend to be normal? Can a kid, like, handle that? I have no idea. But something I have talked about. My wife is down to homeschool also. We've also talked about how to like divvy up their education. It's kind of good because she's really good at certain topics that I am okay at, and I'm really good at certain topics that she's okay at. So yeah, I think that could go really well. I'm gonna get a little bit of the green in this doorway. I think that's what I need to like do right now. But yeah, I'm definitely gonna homeschool my kids, man. I mean, is anyone thinking about sending their kids to public school? Let me know if you are. I'm super curious. I just don't know how I would like negotiate that. I feel like every single day I would have to get in there and be like, okay, what'd they tell you? Oh yeah, that's not how that was. Like, you know what I mean? I have to like really get in and like dig into every aspect of their education to this point where eventually I'd be like, well, now I'm just homeschooling you anyway. Oh, stop. Now I'm just homeschooling you anyway, so. All right, this came out kind of cool. I'm gonna come back in and put some lines on this chair. I don't know what's going to like rope this all together, if it's going to be all roped together. Maybe it'll be one of those kind of pictures where it just feels sort of empty and that's like how it just is. Let's see. Let's see how it goes. What if I added an alien? Yeah, I thought about that. I thought about putting a UFO in the window. I couldn't tell if it was like too cheesy or not. I'm trying to, I mean, that would be cool for sure. I'm just trying to make sure when I do these streams, honestly, that I take it as a chance to not do the thing that I would normally do. You know, I want to try and like make sure that when I do this, I'm always like thinking like, oh, should I do that or not? You know, I'm making sure I'm not doing anything like on autopilot is really the word that I'm looking for. I'm going to put in these shadows. I'm not going to just straight up outline it. I'm just going to put in the shadows on like one side. Perfect. There we go. Cool. Perfect. All right. So yeah, if anyone wants to ask me more stuff, do it. I'll probably wrap this up in like 10, 15 minutes. I totally failed on doing the stream shorter. Oh man, what time I put on the clock, that obviously indicates what time it is, so I should make that a conscious decision. I mean, let's make it like 3 a.m. in this clock right now. It's a good time. There we go. Nice. Put some stars out here too. So yeah, people can ask me more stuff. I'll wrap this up. This was a very informal stream would be the theme of this one. So if you stuck with me this whole time, that's really awesome. I've said this a bunch, but you know, for the first like 10 of these, I'll probably just still be like figuring out exactly how I want to do things. So thanks for hanging out and sticking with me. In some ways that makes it more fun, right? Like me not knowing how it's going to go. And I actually decided I don't like this. Oh man, this is so perfect. I was talking about the contrast thing before. Your eye is just so drawn here because it's high contrast. So I'm just gonna paint that over. It was cool for a minute, but now it's gotta go. All right, I'm gonna put in the smoke from the coffee cup and then we'll see, maybe it'll be done. I don't know. I don't really know how I'm gonna wrap this up, but that's kind of the fun part. So now I'm gonna put in this smoke. I mean, if this was digital, I could put it in at a low opacity, which is kind of what I'm thinking. But I'm really just going to grab the white and just go for it and just throw down like a smoke pattern, almost like there's like steam coming off of it. I could try and figure out how to do it. Oh man, I could put it in at like intentionally opaque. Like I could put it in light gray over the gray, light brown over the brown, white over the yellow. But I don't know, it doesn't feel painterly enough. So I'm not going to do that. Seems to know a lot about history. Can you tell me anything about matriarchal societies? I can't tell if that's a joke or not. No, I can't. Are there any? Have there really been any? Not really. Actually, you know, in case you're not joking, one thing that is interesting is there are some matriarchal groups. There's some like in Africa and stuff, right? That's always like the cliche people appeal to. I'm not saying there's never been any. I mean, there was a queen of Byzantium. Does that make it matriarchal? In my mind, I would say yes, but I think most like sociologists would say no. That looks dope, but I'm gonna make it a little doper. So yeah, there are some matriarchal societies in Africa, but what's funny is that if you really dig into them, they're matriarchal because the men refuse to work. So like, you can get like a matriarchal society, but it's only because like the men are like, yeah, you go get the water. I'm not gonna do it. So it's really funny. If you dig into like some sociology paper and they're talking about like a matriarchal group, you should look, don't believe me. You should look into it and see, because that's a really like funny hidden aspect of all that stuff that people don't really talk about. I'm not saying they're all like that. I'm not saying I've studied the matter in depth, but I have noticed that when I've looked into it every now and then. All right, that looks pretty dope. Maybe it's a little too illustrative, but whatever. Is 5 children too many? No, dude, I have like 15 kids. You guys heard my goal about not being able to fit all my kids into one minivan. That's like literally the goal. All right, so I really like how this looks, actually. This is a really good example of what I've been talking about, where it's like I kind of just want to do something I haven't done before and see how it goes and like wing it and just see what happens. This was really fun and cool. I just feel like it's missing like a little something. Here's what we're gonna do. Since I am like winging this whole stream, I'm gonna look away from this for just a second. I'll take like a question or two and I'll look back and see if anything comes up, like any ideas I have for what to do. But let's see. New question. What biblical story has been the most useful and eye-opening for you in your life? Damn, that's such a good question. What Bible story has been the most eye-opening or useful for me in my everyday life? Really don't know, man. I'm thinking of a lot of them. I mean, in some ways, the creation story, the fall, stuff like that, just because I really do think every day about being in like a fallen world and stuff like that. That's kind of a cop-out. Let me think about that one. I don't want to just stumble through like a random answer, so let me think about the Bible story thing. Probably the fall. That's probably my answer. Huh, I kind of feel like, what else? Maybe there's nothing else I can get in here. I mean, maybe this is how it is. I mean, the more I'm looking at it, the more I'm like, this is pretty dope. Really kind of captures like part of my feelings about being in a hospital. Honestly, yeah, I think I'm good. I hate to end it on like a should I do anything else, I guess not feeling, but actually, yeah, I do really like how this came out. Cool. All right, like I said, I'm experimenting with the format. I guess I could have talked more about like hospitals and like me being in them, but I've been in them a bunch recently, so maybe that's why this kind of like kicked up from my subconscious, like hanging out in them. I'm going to do it on Monday again. I'm probably going to do it on Friday also. So yeah, I really like how this came out. I really like the kind of like jaundice-y color I got on the inside. If I did this again, I would do a few things differently, but also this is a good example of like sketching, painting, and just feeling it out, just going for it. It doesn't have to be perfect every time. Although, I actually do like how this came out. Let's wrap it up on the Bible story note. I really want to have a good answer for you, but I kind of don't. I don't know why my mind's going blank. Probably because I've just been talking and painting for like so long. I don't know. I mean, okay. Is this a cop-out? I mean, I feel like my answer is just like the whole story of Genesis together. I'm not just saying that because I want to have an answer. If I didn't have an answer, I would just say that. But there's just something about the whole story all together where man is made, you know, to tend this garden and they kind of fuck it up and then they're released in the world and, you know, they have the Cain and Abel story and then there's Noah's Ark and then eventually at the end, it's at the end of Genesis, right, where Joseph has, like, the dream coat, right, and then he has his brothers, he gets exiled to Egypt, and then his brothers come there, and they don't know who he is. Kind of the whole stretch of, like, the fall to Joseph, I see as kind of, like, one thing, and I guess in a weird way, those are the stories I relate to the most, almost because they, I mean, I don't want to say they don't make sense, that's really not what I'm saying. I feel like their meaning is inherently enigmatic. So for that reason, I often come back to them in my daily life where, you know, if I'm having a conflict with someone, like sometimes I do think about the conflicts, you know, in Genesis and my family, like people fight in my family. So sometimes I think about, you know, the conflicts in the family in Genesis. And I guess because they're in Genesis, it makes me feel like more so than other parts of the Bible, even though this isn't really justifiable theologically. Is that it's almost like they're written in more into the inherent experience of everyday life in a weird way. Like the two first brothers, one kills the other, you know, and you're out in your life and you see all these people having these conflicts and, you know, God has to flood the earth to get rid of like sinful people and things like that. So I don't know. I don't really have like a very direct answer there for you, but the whole stretch from Genesis to Joseph's story is something I think about a lot. So I guess that you could say that's the most influential. It's not really one story. Kind of a cop out, but not really. Very powerful vibe today. Thanks, dude. Thanks. All right. Yeah, Genesis is very archetypal. Yeah. All right. Cool. Okay, I'm gonna wrap this up right now. If you watch the whole thing, if you watch even part of it, thanks. That's really awesome. This is a really interesting one. We had like a situation with the lag, and I had to like figure that out. But also just painting wise. I really wanted to do something I haven't done before, and I haven't fully stepped into doing that on the stream. Normally, I kind of have like one foot in the puddle of things I've done before and one foot in the puddle of things that I am experimenting with, but here I kind of just went for it. I really want the streams to be more like that. Like, there's part of my ego that is thinking like, oh man, like the painting has to look good and, you know, I really want it to be like perfect and should I leave this one up on YouTube? Like if the painting doesn't end up perfect, like, but actually the whole goal of this, the whole point of this isn't so I have like a bunch of paintings. Like I don't even know what I'm going to do with these. They're probably just going to go on the wall in my studio. But I want to encourage other people to like do creative stuff, whether it's, you know, music or art, or that sounds kind of pretentious. No one's going to start doing music or art because of me, but just talking about my process and being creative and stuff like that, I guess. Yeah, man. Anyway, if you check this out, obviously, if you watched it, you're here at the end with me. That's awesome, man. It's really flattering. I feel like I'm still kind of figuring it out. So even though this one wasn't perfect, it was really fun. I hope you guys had fun hanging out with me. I had a lot of fun hanging out with you guys. We'll get it perfect eventually. Eventually, we'll crack, you know, the 20th, 50th stream, and it'll be perfect. There'll never be any mistakes. Everything will go perfect every time. But for now, we're just riding the tiger. That's what they say, right? Cool. So thanks for checking this out. This is really fun for me. I look forward to this like all day, every Tuesday. And yeah, man, hit me up. If anyone ever wants to hit me up and be like, yo, I watched it. It was dope. Or there was this part that, you know, maybe didn't really work or whatever. Like, let me know. Like, I'm still definitely in like gathering feedback mode. And yeah, guys, thanks a lot for hanging out. I hope you guys have a really good night and have a really good week. And everything's going well for you guys, man. Thanks a lot for checking this out. And I will catch you guys on the rest of the internet where we hang out. See you guys later. Thanks, guys.